Nope.
Those are off.
They're on.
Okay, we're on, all right. All right, welcome to the Policy Committee meeting for December 19th. First question is, has the meeting been properly posted? Lynn?
Yes, we have.
Yes, it has, thank you. And any opportunities for citizens to speak? Any citizens? Apparently not, so we will move right through that. We have a number of action items this evening. First one is the approval of the policy minutes from our November meeting. I would be seeking a motion for approval of the minutes.
I move to approve the minutes.
Thank you.
Of the last policy committee.
Okay, thank you. Is there seconded by Greg? Any questions, changes, or whatever on the minutes? All in favor of accepting the minutes as written, please say aye.
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 Opposed? 5-0, Lynn.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, then we have seven policy revisions, or one is a new policy, actually, to go through tonight, which will be, we will go through them and have the, hopefully have the first reading in January. So these we will go through in more detail this evening than sometimes we have. The first is policy 5130, withdrawal slash dropout. And I'm going to go to Joel for background on this one, because this gets a little hairier than some of them.
Yeah, there, you know, the dropout provision was added to this policy, and you can see we've had increased requirements for state reporting, and we've talked about that as a whole board and workshop and through various committees. So the state now does a much more comprehensive job of tracking where kids end up. To support a student who, I guess to back up a little bit, compulsory attendance requires that a kid be in school through their 17th year, 364th day. And then when they're 18 years old, they can choose to drop out of school or not. Students who withdraw from school to various entities. They'll withdraw from Waukesha to enroll in a district or into another state. That student gets tracked. Some students withdraw from school to go to home-based private education. If you're less than 18 years old, you need to be enrolled in some sort of program. And that a lot of that becomes the, you know, the parents' responsibility. What this language does, it just clarifies what the district steps are in the instance that a student withdraws or drops out to from school. If you remember back, we've talked about our at-risk services, and a lot of that came through the Teaching and Learning Committee. We do then track and try to monitor those students who have dropped out, do some outreach to them to try to get them to come back, earn a diploma through our EAST programs. So we do some follow-up there, but the language and the policies really directs us as administration as to how we should approach a student who withdraws.
Okay, and that's what's covered in this one, and we have new language that's colored in green.
And if I could just explain see the green underline with what looks like a highlighter. As we all learn with technology, Board Docs did an upgrade, and the upgrade was made it prohibitive to print in color at the time being. So you'll have to note that we are going through and highlighting any changes. Board Docs and Neola are working on that upgrade glitch.
That's why the green and red highlighting is on here. Barbara?
Yes, Joe, sometimes kids drop out, move away, and we can't find them. We know that that happens. But it may happen that they would need to verify a diploma if they were looking for a job. So what do we say?
We track where kids go after they leave. So if you leave Waukesha and go to a neighboring district, our records would indicate that we shipped those student records off to that neighboring district. We do have a number of students, for a variety of reasons, who will leave us, and we don't have any idea where they're at.
Right.
And their status is left withdraw to unknown location.
Okay.
When that student's cohort hits graduation, that withdraw to unknown location counts as a dropout for Waukesha. So again, that's one of the reasons why, you know, the tracking is important, our outreach is important, our social workers are very involved with the, you know, students who are more at risk, but th- this is what.
Yeah, I know we work real hard to do everything we can to keep them in school or to give them services. However, how many kids would you say? I know our number's pretty low for a big district.
Well, there's two numbers. There are kids who formally drop out, and I don't have that at hand. But then there's the DPI, how they count graduates.
Yeah.
And you know that we have a very good 5-year graduation rate.
Yeah, we do.
Our 4-year graduation rate is something we strive to continue to improve. So, I don't want to base dropouts and withdrawals off of either one of those numbers because I don't believe that either one is truly an accurate reporting.
Okay.
Students who formally drop out, there are probably more students who get coded into that than we know. If you look at the DPI information, there's 3 completer categories. You know, there is the traditional diploma, there are those kids that complete high school, and then there are students who drop out. And all of those numbers look different based off of how they've established cohorts in the DPI.
Thank you, Joe.
Okay. Joe, one of the issues in here deals with the fact that we are obligated to try and track these kids down when they're not the easy ones, but the ones that are just disappeared. Have we been pretty much on course with that? And this is really just putting it in words.
Correct. Yeah. So our procedure for trying to track down is sending certified mail as a first step to the last known address. And then beyond that, sending a social worker out to try to verify where, in fact, this particular student is. But we're a very large district, and we serve a very diverse group of students. Some of our students, would be international in nature, and so they may be here for a while, and through a job transfer, they go overseas, and we don't know where they're enrolled in school, and we don't see them again. We don't get a records request. Those students then stay on our roll, withdraw to unknown location. We have some families that will go abroad for long vacations. They'll say they're going back to their home country to visit family. They may or they may not come back from that. And so we have a variety of students that we need to serve. We also have kids that legitimately get to a point and drop out of school. So through this policy, we try to capture all of those students that would either be withdrawing or dropping out of our schools.
So from a funding perspective, obviously we lose money if they're not there on the third Friday count. Mm-hmm. And then it also shows up as a negative on the report card. Those are kind of the two dings that we get for this. One other thing I just wanted to ask you about how we handle this is letter C. Who works with the student on that? And do we actually get? I mean, I'm thinking, are these students really setting goals? Are they even responsible for moving or dropping out? You know what I'm saying? They're not likely to be if it's a troubled family scenario. They're probably not thinking about future goals, and it might not even be the students. Decision to be in this category. So how do we actually work with them, and how successful are we trying to understand their goals?
So through teaching and learning last school year, we had a discussion of what our at-risk plan was, and that was presented to teaching and learning for committee approval, and then there was an update provided to the board. In the state statute requires grades 5 through 12. We notify all families if their child is at risk of not graduating from high school. So there are measures in fifth grade that we can use to predict if that child would in fact be at risk. The service part of that is our school psychologists, social workers, and counselors are reaching out to those students at a much younger age now to begin to connect with the child and the family, to establish some plans, to help set goals, to help reconnect with school so that we can, curb those, get those kids back to school, attending on a more regular basis. We did some work with a county coalition on truancy. A lot of the students who are falling into this category are young truants. So we're really working with our court system and with the county social workers to make sure those kids are wrapped back in and brought back to school. to talk about success, you know, I think that the success that we see from our at-risk services, which our history has been at the high school, is we do a very good job of getting kids graduated through their fifth year of high school, so that additional year. Last Friday, we just set an update that talked about the number of super seniors that had come back, the number of kids that have completed, or the number of seniors who through the comp program have graduated early. That's really where our focus has been. We're beginning to shift that down to the younger grades to make those contacts. And so hopefully, I think that the true measure of success would be fewer and fewer kids needing the services that we provide through East and graduating in a four-year period.
Any other questions?
One more.
Yes. Hmm?
Please.
Go ahead.
In our 18 to 21 program, is that a special needs program?
That's for students who have been identified with disabilities.
Thank you.
Yes.
Yeah, and
but I would add the caveat to that is a lot of the students at East are 19 and 20.
Yes, they are.
19 and 20,
mm-hmm.
And the state statute requires us to serve any student who lives within the district from ages 4 through their 20th okay. birthday.
Yes.
Disability or not.
Yes.
And you'll notice that that is point D. Mm-hmm. In these superintendent requirements.
Mm-hmm.
And so to get back to the original question, yes, we've been doing this for a long time. This policy just makes sure we catch okay. it.
And aside, your comment about you just sent us some information about the kids graduating in the fifth year and so on. That was really nice to see that in last week's thing. It was in the packet. By coincidence, I was over and talked to Tiara today, so that was nice. I could compliment them, that staff on doing that.
That's yeah, been great. Staff does a phenomenal job getting kids caught up.
Here they are.
Yes.
I move approval to 5130, withdrawal dropout from school, as presented.
Second.
Seconded by Barbara. Any further questions on 5130?
Bill, may I?
Oh, Amanda, yes, please.
Just kind of want to... second paragraph, that's underlined in green. Can you, Joe, tell me, it says no student under the age of 18 will be permitted to withdraw without written consent of the parent and the approval of the superintendent. What does it mean, the approval of the superintendent? If the parent's there and gives their reason, what does that mean?
The approval of the superintendent would be the caveat that the second sentence there. The withdrawal of any student under the age of 18 must comply with the requirements for participation in the program leading to the high school's graduation. That's the district's obligation to make sure that that student who is trying to withdraw from us has the intention of enrolling in the program. And that would be withdrawing to home-based private education. There is the wish of the parent, but the compulsory attendance law still does not allow the parent to just take their kid out of school and not make sure that they're enrolled in either a public school, a private or parochial school, home-based education, a tribal school, a virtual charter school. You can't just leave the public school and go your own way. The parent has to provide a direction for that child. It's my intention to take my child to home-based education, homeschool. That's the parent's option, and then the superintendent can approve that withdrawal. And if you remember in our policies, superintendent more broadly means designee.
Right, right. So. Yeah. I know it's not one specific individual, but just the way I'm reading it, it's the way I interpret it, it says despite what the parents' wishes are, the kid can't leave until the superintendent or the designee says, yes, it's okay. That's right. What this is saying.
That's what that says. We can't just release you to nowhere. We must maintain you on our books until we know where you have.
And that's is that the statute that's stated
that
back here?
Compulsory attendance law, yes.
Compulsory attendance, thank you. Okay, thank you.
Good question, Joe.
So have we ever had a case like that, or where the superintendent or designee didn't get an appropriate plan for the student?
There's no situation that I'm aware of where there wasn't an appropriate plan. Parents who wish to go to the homeschool indicate that that's where they're going with their child. They register with the state that there's going to be homeschool, and that's the end of that. Parents that request or that take their children to a virtual charter school, a tribal school, a private or parochial school, they request records. Our records, and then get passed along.
Okay. But those that just up and disappear wouldn't have done any of that.
They wouldn't have done any of that, and then we
those cases would occur, but...
Those kids then stay on our books. They're not considered withdrawals. They turn into dropouts for us. So that's kind of the catch on it. We can't say, you know, 12th grade student Joe, who's 17 years old, your parents aren't letting you go. I mean, I'm on the school district of Waukesha's books until I show up at another location or till my cohort graduates and then I count it. So that's really what that paragraph captures. There was a time when students who dropped out didn't count towards the graduation rate. And if you go into the description that you have in the background section, you talk about the WISE data system. That's the catch for all of those students. That's that student number. We can't release that student number anywhere. We then maintain that number until that gets shipped up somewhere else.
Okay. No other questions, then we have a motion and a second. All in favor of accepting revisions to policy 5130, please say aye.
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 Opposed?
Thank you.
5-0. Thank you. Next one is policy 5540. This one, quite simply, is a terminology change, moving from the term police officer to law enforcement officer, and that is the entirety of the revisions in this one. Any issues with that? I was going to back up just a minute, please. Lynn, when you and I were talking, some of these are recommendations and some of these are do it, right? Weren't there some that were recommendations and we could pick or choose on them? Or is that still coming?
Some of those are still coming. These are mainly...
Were these required?
Catching up with state statutes.
Okay.
And current...
And this would be one of those.
Yes, this policy is more current terms. If you,
yeah.
Police officer is limiting. Law enforcement agency is more broad as to who may or may not be coming into a school. So.
Any questions on this one, Barbara?
Section 48.981, is that the state law about education?
That is not the state law about education. That is the mandatory reporting requirements that the administration must follow. So,
but it's a state law.
It is in states, yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, I will seek a motion for approval of 5540.
I move to approve the revisions to policy 5540, the schools and governmental agencies as presented.
Thank you. Is there a second?
I'll second.
Moved and seconded. Is there any further question? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? 5-0, Lynn.
Thank you.
And that takes us to policy number 5771, search and seizure. There's two parts of changes here. One is the same one. We're changing terminology from police liaison to the school resource officer, which is actually a term we've been using in any case, but that's what's written in here. And then we have a second part to this one where we have allowed optional school staff to be designated to perform searches and drug tests, et cetera, and that's in the two-thirds of the way down on the first page. Did you want to present anything on this one, Joel?
This more captures how we've been operating. You know, if we do suspect that a student has alcohol on their breath, we do request that the school resource officer or we call in a squad to come in and perform a breath test. And then this talks about, you know, refusal and how it violates school rules and such.
Again, is this basically what we're doing? That's what
this
you're
is
saying,
what we're
yeah.
doing, yes.
Barbara?
Yes, Do our principals ever, are they ever able to assign the student for a blood test? Because there would be a cost to them.
That's the police responsibility.
And they...
If a blood test is necessary,
okay.
We can request the breath test.
Okay, and then who would pay for that blood test?
That's between the police and the family.
Okay.
That is not, that's, the district does not request the blood
Great.
Test.
Thank you.
Okay, any additions to this one, changes, questions? Seek a motion then for approval of 5771.
I'll move to approve revisions as presented to policy 5771, search and seizure.
Thank you.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Como. Further questions? All in favor of accepting it, please say aye.
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 Opposed? 5-0, Lynn.
Thank you.
This brings us to policy revision 5830. And Lynn, I have a curiosity question, maybe more than anything else, because it ends by talking about leads into policy 6605. And then on the bottom it says something about AG 6605. Is there some confusion that we need to understand here?
No confusion. Crowdfunding, which you see in the next policy and we'll discuss in the next policy, is when people are using GoFundMe sites and, you know, they're putting a random request out for additional funding. And so we need to clarify that, because that is something that's very real in society today. This policy here, the administrative guidelines, so when you see AG, that is administrative guidelines, and that would be the superintendent's rules on how they want that policy carried out. So it sometimes in policy you will see that all activities such as this, all crowdfunding activities, are subject to AG 65 or 6605. When you look at the options that were selected, the top one there, just above option one, in accordance with 2430, we want the superintendent to know if the school district of Waukesha anything is being used to raise funding, raise funds. Superintendent again goes to designee, so we may talk about Waukesha North basketball doing a fundraiser for. That approval might end up at the athletic director's level, but something more broadly to fund the bigger project, that may then go through the superintendent. That would be sorted out through administrative guidelines on the policy.
Now, when we got into the process with NEOLA, we changed some of the terminology about administrative guidelines. Some of the administrative guidelines were moved into policies imprinted in here. And others were going to be Todd's rules, and they're going to be in a binder someplace. Which one is this? This one is...
There are the idea of Todd's, the old administrative guidelines that were in our old policy series, all of the ones that were current and were, in essence, board policy, were migrated into the associated board policy.
In that book. They're
and
in here
is our
now.
New, and what is our new policy series?
That's what this one would be, one of those?
Six? No.
Oh.
So the administrative, all of the old board, all of the old policy guidelines were board approved.
Right.
The administrative guidelines at the time were taken up as, you know, issue by issue. If something came up, how do we want to apply this in our system? What we have in the NEOLA book is board policy. It's everything that you approve as a board. In some instances, those policies include procedures. Again, those are board-approved procedures. That's how we must act. When you see AG 6605, that is the superintendent's rules. That is not a board-approved rule. That is a superintendent-approved rule
that
supports the associated policy. So AG 6605 would support the implementation of policy 6605.
Okay.
So when we get into crowdfunding, we'll talk about crowdfunding, and then that's when we would be developing the associated administrative guidelines.
Okay, and that's, so there is no, in the NEOLA, if we went on the computer and looked them, pulled these up, we would not get an AG 6605.
Yes, you would. It's in a separate series. It's just not board approved. So
it's just not board approved, it's one that, okay.
And then you'll see the administrative guidelines. It's all for the public to view.
They're in there as well.
They're in there as well. You just go to a different tab, board policy, administrative guidelines,
okay,
and you can search the policy, or you can search the website for those.
Good. Thank you. Joe.
Yeah, I remember 2 years ago, I don't remember the exact time, there There was a school or a parent at a school that wanted to raise some funds in this manner for air conditioning for the school. And with that in mind, I'm thinking we might want to modify that option two paragraph where it says crowdfunding activities aimed at raising funds for a specific classroom or school activity. I would suggest us maybe even broadening it a little bit further, maybe something like crowdfunding activities aimed at raising funds for maybe school enhancements, comma, specific classroom or school activity. So something that's just broadly covers the building or the school as a whole. So I don't know if the school enhancement works there.
Or even capital projects, I mean.
Perhaps, sure.
Well, you're saying it because we, in order to do that, you want to be sure that we're getting approval from Todd or Spender.
Right, yeah. Right. So what kinds of activities are...
To broaden this to say, make sure we're getting approval on all these things rather than letting somebody run loose on it.
Yeah.
We can insert that language in there.
We put that in? Good. Thank you. And again, this is one of those where we picked our choices on here for the option one and the option two, and that's what
this was done in consultation with the business office. So we sat down and met and reviewed this policy, and from a day-to-day operations standpoint, this is what Darren felt were the most usable options for our school system.
Okay. Other questions on 5830? When we have a motion on this one, it'll be including the terminology change.
As amended.
Okay. You want to make the motion?
Yeah, sure. I'll move to approve 5830 student fundraising as amended.
Second.
Seconded by Amanda. Good. Further questions? All in favor of accepting it, please say aye.
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 5830 is approved. 5-0.
Thank you.
You got it, right, Lynn?
I got it.
Thank you.
Yep.
Okay. Now we have in front of us the new policy 6605 crowdfunding. And this is a new policy or a new AG?
It's a new policy.
This is the policy. Okay.
And we'll then have new administrative guidelines after the policy is approved by the board.
Okay. And again, this was selecting options. We picked option two with specific approval, and then maybe we should make the same terminology in here. Joe, what do you think?
I would agree with that.
Okay.
Parallel the...
Yeah. Okay. Can we do that, Lynn?
Yep.
And actually, I had a note to myself to get an explanation of the AG on it, and you did that already, so I'm okay with that.
I would just add an important line. Mm-hmm. Funding used to obtain school classroom equipment shall become the property of the school district.
Oh, yeah.
There is some question as to if I use GoFundMe to buy something for my classroom, should I be the one who gets to bring it with me, or does it become part of the school? We want to be explicit that if you fundraise for the school, it is the school's property.
And take it with you to the next grade.
Okay, can I make the same motion, Joe?
Sure, I'll move approval of the new policy 6605 crowdfunding as amended.
Thank you. Is there a second? Seconded by Amanda. Further questions? Seeing none, I will seek a motion. Approval. All those in favor say aye.
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 And against? 5-0 it is. Thank Lynn, thank you. Okay, cross that off. Now we have revisions to policy 6152, student fees, fines, and charges. And I start with another question, because it says in here to remove reference to food service policy decisions, but I don't see any removals in here.
That's true.
Was there another change, or?
That would be something we'd have to go back and check that.
Paragraph above the new language was recommended to be struck out.
The students will not will not be permitted to purchase that one.
The original recommendation from NEOLA was to take out the language, students will not be permitted to purchase a meal from the food service department, but will instead be provided an alternative meal until the school collects delinquent lunch balances. In looking at what was approved through student fees, as well as what our practice is, Darren and Sherry Stack had requested that this paragraph remain in policy so that we can collect mm-hmm. on unpaid balances, and so that we do not continue to accrue large lunch balances. We can be more proactive in capturing that.
So the sentence on our background is incorrect.
Yes, that needs to be updated.
I'll update that for.
Okay, so I'm gonna read the background. Now, the policy is updated to reflect collection authority pertaining to food service. Period. And that's why there's nothing redded out on the other. Okay, thank you. That clarifies my concern, Barbara.
Yes. I recall that sometimes it's impossible to collect. Then what?
That is in this policy. The CFO is authorized by the board to use a collection agency to address delinquent fees. So if you look at the added language there, the district shall not permit or elicit the assistance of volunteers in efforts to collect unpaid student fees. The sentence prior to that talks about us using a collection agency to capture unpaid balances. What we want to be explicit about in policy is that for our parent volunteers who assist in the office, we're not having them do the follow-up work with families. And we just want to make sure that that does not happen in our system, and that's what this policy language assists us with. A collection agency, if we're going to go that route for families that are delinquent in fees, is the appropriate vehicle to capture our unpaid dollars.
Joe.
Was there a reason that NEOLA presented to strike that students will not be permitted paragraph?
There's a lot of debate about lunch, whose responsibility it is to provide lunch, and should school districts have an alternative lunch for students who do not have money in their accounts. We have gone to great lengths as a school district to make sure that all of our students in some of our schools are given free lunch, free breakfast. We accommodate free and reduced lunch. From time to time, we address other hardships as they come, and we're made aware of them. But we do want to have the option as a district to provide the alternate lunch so that the balance doesn't grow up. There's a debate across the country as to should you be providing everybody lunch and not penalizing, or should you try to capture that balance. From a practical standpoint, and I've got small kids, my wife and I get an email that indicates your child's balance is at a dollar left or your child's balance is in the red, and we're able then to capture it right away. Mm-hmm. That's what this helps us do.
And this would not be a kid that's got free and reduced lunch because they're already covered.
Correct.
So this is somebody that at least has been identified as being able to pay for their own lunches.
This is somebody who's got an account. Yeah. There's a positive balance in there. They're buying what they need to buy. That account gets dry. It's a good first step towards helping the family remember that they have a balance there.
In our system, if a parent gets this notification, how long does it take for them to make?
That's case by case.
Yeah.
No, assuming they have the money.
They can do that from home.
And do it from home without coming in and dropping off money. So that I wanted to make that clear.
Rev track is.
Yeah, I can send in a check with our children to school. We You can go right online, put money in their accounts immediately. Yeah, it's very accessible.
A little bit different from my day.
Track is really convenient. I mean, I didn't get to use it either.
You had lunch at St. Sebastian's?
No, it's at Pius.
Oh, at Pius, yeah. Great school. God.
Okay. Any other changes regarding... I lost my place. I'm in the wrong one now. Good. 6152. I think we took care of the one thing we had and understood the rest. Is there a motion for approval of 6152?
Yes, I'll approve revisions to policy number 6152, student fees, fines, and charges as presented.
Thank you. Seconded by?
I'll second.
Seconded by Greg. Any further questions? All in favor of accepting the revisions to 6152, please say aye.
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 Opposed? 5-0 then.
Thank you.
And last, we have policy 6800, system of accounting. And we have, looks like just one addition into this one. The board has a resolution designated institute as by resolution designated institutions to serve as depositories of all direct funds and may by resolution designate additional or different institutions. What more can be said on this one?
It's just that the board approves the banks that we're using.
And we've been doing that
for a long time.
For a long time, yeah. That's nothing new to us.
So there's nothing...
in the form of resolutions, too,
yeah,
so.
There's nothing particular.
So we use more than one bank?
I don't have a list of all of them, but I do know what Darren indicated that we have more than one.
More than one, okay.
Barbara?
And Greg, you might remember that each school, you know, would go to the bank around their school, so there are several different banks.
Okay, I'll seek a motion for approval of 6800.
All right, I'll move to approve the revisions to policy number 6800, system of accounting, as presented.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Seconded by Greg. Any further questions? In favor of that revision, please say aye.
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 Opposed? None. 5-0. Okay. Those will all be brought to the January board meeting.
As a first reading.
For the first reading. Mm-hmm. And one of them will have a slightly different first reading than we have here tonight because, well, actually two of them. We inserted that one on the crowdfunding. The terminology that we present at the meeting will include that part about other things,
yes,
for the schools.
As amended.
Yep, okay, got it. Okay, the other item we have, policy 2370, educational options, and new policy 8146, notification of educational options, was read to the board in December, bringing it back to the board for action item in January. And if I can find my copy of it, I don't think we had any changes to that, did we? Yeah, that's the one right there. All the red. Well, that's the
one that was simplified.
Yeah. Well, all of that was deleted.
And on the next page.
And on the next page. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I don't think we have anything more on changing on that one. Everybody's cool with that. It's really quite simply the online process has eliminated the need for all the words
on paper. It went from a policy that talked about the program that we must require to a policy of what we must notify the public of.
Right. Okay. Do we have to take action on that again to bring it back for second reading? I don't think so. We're just okay.
I don't think there was any changes.
Yeah, and there are no changes, so we're okay with that one. Discussion items, other business. You have a 10A1I, possible addition of a Narcan policy. Joe, you want to explain a little bit of what's coming at there?
Yeah, so Narcan is the antidote, that wouldn't be the right word. It's the anti-drug that reverses the effects of an opioid overdose. So somebody overdoses on heroin, you can give them Narcan. That gives them a kind of a life-saving bridge to get them to the hospital. It can do a short-term reversal. If you go beyond heroin and you think of things like Vicodin and oxycodone and things that people who have suffered injuries or maybe going through a certain cancer treatment may have in their homes, you then start to get into a situation that's probably more applicable to a school system. Where a child would get into a medicine cabinet, perhaps ingest some medicine, either at school or on their way to school by accident out of curiosity, and we'd be dealing with an overdose situation at school. Many of our neighboring districts are implementing Narcan policies right now because of that very reason, the readily available opioids in the home. And I'm going to be bringing some policy language to you in January for the board, for the committee, and then the board to consider, so that we could have Narcan on hand in our offices in the event that that would happen. We do have that in place right now for EpiPens. So the bee sting allergies or the nut allergies, we do have those life-saving measures on in our schools right now. This unfortunately has turned into a life-saving measure that is becoming more and more appropriate for schools to have on hand. Waukesha Police do have Narcan in their squads. They know how to administer it. Sometimes the time to get an officer there, you know, you're talking minutes instead of being able to administer something in seconds. So,
is there any training that goes with delivering it, and is there any risk involved to the deliverer?
There's no risk to the deliverer, no more risk than what would be for the EpiPen. There is training that's associated with it. In order to have it on hand, you have to designate who's going to be trained. The folks that we are tentatively thinking about would be our health room assistants, as well as our principals. Those are generally the folks that are on hand and ready to do it. We have talked to the Waukesha Police Department. They do have a trainer who can come in. We would be looking at the nasal Narcan as the delivery method, so that it wouldn't be not as invasive as an EpiPen. It would be straight in the nose. So,
yeah, I actually had witnessed someone administering an EpiPen incorrectly and administered it to themselves. They had it turned backwards. Right into their hand. And so we had two people that needed to be taken away by ambulance. So I'm glad to hear that it's a nasal application.
Right, it's a nasal application.
Maybe a little less complex, but, you know, it sounds like it's just simple, but, you know, you do need to be trained in how to properly administer and make sure it's done right.
UW system at all of its campuses recently approved Narcan on hand at the college level because of the issues that they were running into with opioid overdoses. So, you know, we public schools, school systems are generally the next.
And I thought it's available over the counter now at pharmacies.
Correct.
I thought I heard a pharmacist that I know say that is available now. Don't quote me on that, but I thought that was the case. I think it's a fact, but
given how readily available opioids are, it is becoming more and more common to have Narcan around. Closely, if you remember back last school year, we did have that heroin presentation at South High School, where we had about 500 community members and district staff show up. It is you see it in our state legislature, you see it at the federal level. I mean, it is an issue that our country is now wrestling with.
Yes, Joe, I think that maybe we should mention in the possible policy that the EpiPen or whatever it is that children need should go with them on a field trip, because, you know, you go to field trips sometimes on the farm or into Milwaukee, and, you know, I think of the camping trip we would go on overnight, and it is in there.
It is in there.
Okay, all of good.
The field trip organizer must notify the health room within a week, week's time, so that the health room assistant can get the medications prepared.
Very good.
For any field trip, and then that those medications are brought along for situations where we have kids who have diabetic needs. Have 504 plans, we are required to send trained district staff on those field trips as well so that those students could get their care if need be. Even if the parent is along on the field trip, we still have to send the staff along. So, I mean, we have completely covered that. Where the Narcan policy would come in, it would probably be in addition to our medication distribution policy. Our guidelines that would be developed based off of recommendations from the DPI. And if we were to do this, and actually we have a meeting, I think it's after the first of the year, with our district medical provider, the doctor who writes the prescriptions for our EpiPens, she is coming in to review our what we're proposing for the Narcan language. So it's going to be comprehensive, and it's going to make sure that from the medical community to the Board of Ed to administration that we all have a good comfort around what it is that we're doing.
Okay, any other ideas for future committee meetings that somebody else wants to raise? No? Okay. Any other as needed items? Everybody have a good holiday season. Merry Christmas and Happy New Year, and safe, please. Don't know what weather's coming at us next, but today started off as a gorgeous day and it ended up getting kind of cold out there, but I know that because I was okay, this meeting is adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you.